started. Anita's passing out our budget, but in the meantime, let's go ahead and get going. Hi, I'm Claudia Guerra. I'm the Alta Vista president for this year. And thank you, everyone, for coming. It's great to see such a big turnout. We've got a couple of really important things to talk about, so I'm going to rush through a few things to make sure that we get through some of the two big issues that I think a lot of people are here for regarding some of the properties and the development issues that are going on them. But I don't want to skip out on our regular committee reports, including the budget, which Anita is handing out. And I'm going to talk a little bit more about that. I was hoping that we would ratify a budget today, but I think we're going to put it off, and I'll talk a little bit more about that. But I still want to talk about it so that we can prioritize where you think the money should be spent, because this is, after all, your money. It's the AVNA's money, and I would like membership to have more to say. So before we get too much further, I want to do a roll call of the board. And then the board members, if you would also just sort of stand, because I'm not sure everybody knows us all yet. So, David Garza is our vice president. And also, Anita Bella is our budget, our treasurer. Donna Garrett is a member at large. Treasurer is still on the board, but she couldn't make it here today. So thank you, everyone. And I do, before we go get started, I can't thank Erin enough for everything that she's done to get us to where we are. And I need to thank her again for helping us through this transition time. As you know, there are these little things that you don't think about. It's like, well, how do I access the AVNA email? How do I access our Facebook page? How do all those little things that need to be tidied up, that's kind of what we've been working on. So again, thank you, Erin, for being such a helpful person. Absolutely. So let's look at the minutes. You know, the minutes have been handed out. These are the minutes from November, and I'm going to give everyone just a couple of minutes to go through them. And then I'd like to see if we can get, if there are any changes, discussions, if not, we need to. Tino, as a secretary, do you have anything in the minutes that you'd like to point out? And a couple of things that are on there, we're actually following up today, including the CCR request from the councilman for updating our NCD standards.
Move for adoption with any changes noted.
Are there any changes? Is there a second?
I'll second it.
Okay. All those in favor?
Aye.
Any nays? Okay. Thank you. And now, Anita, can we have a quick treasurer's report?
Yes, ma'am. I handed out a year-end report for 2016 based on the information provided over the course of the year. When you look at the numbers, revenues over expenses, we were positive 1708.73. We started off, we have an ending cash balance of a little bit over $2,500. I tried to give some detail on the revenues and then the expenses that occurred over the course of the year. One of the reasons, and then we do have some designated funds which are noted at the bottom, so those are funds that can be used for just general purposes. We had talked about doing a budget at this meeting, but I thought that it was important, and I spoke to Claudia about this, that you know, that we get more consensus about what we want to see with the group going forward. Is it, do you want to see parties? Do you want to do other, you know, Claudia has mentioned some things that she wants to do. But frankly, our revenues have been pretty flat from 15 to 16. So, you know, the revenues that you see here is what we're going to probably have going forward unless we have a real uptick in fundraising or membership. So that's about it.
So, yeah, so you're saying, Lisa, we can talk a little bit more about it. So most of our money, our income, is from membership dues. And most of what we spend comes out of that membership dues. So every time we have an expenditure for, say, the Christmas party, the way we look at that is if it costs us $400, that's the cost of 40 members. So I think what we want to do is, as a group, have a discussion about where we want those monies. Are we raising the numbers of our membership? Are we fundraising in other ways? Jen Koshman has done some great creative fundraising for a movie night out, which pays for itself by using GoFundMe. Is that what you do? And so that ends up paying for itself. So what we want to bring to you next time is some of the ways that we can spend our money. We've sort of spent it somewhat consistently and somewhat inconsistently. Sometimes we have a one-off type of expenditure. So we as the executive committee want to regroup and look at that. And one of the reasons that we don't have it ready this time is that we started getting requests from people to fund other things. So Jen turned in an arts committee funding request, and we'd like to have time to go through that and see which of those as a membership we're willing to fund. And then coming down to the hard question about, well, if we're funding this, how are we paying for it? So that you can see exactly how much it's going to cost us and what we would need to fundraise. As Anita said, there were some things that we as a membership talked about doing last fall. One of those was having a charrette with the AIA. That's going to cost us some funds. So how we pay for that is part of our question as well. And so I think it would be fun to do some fundraising, but we would need some commitments from people to help us do that. So we'll go into a little more detail about that, and we'll do a little sort of a question and answer with you about what kinds of events, what kinds of funding you want to do. One of the things I'd like to point out is we do spend a lot of money on our social events. And that was a big commitment that we made 2 or 3 years ago. The membership wanted to see more community events, wanted to see more social events. It's happening, and I think it's working. I think it's brought in a greater membership. So that, I think, is a success. It means we have to pay something, but it's a success. So I think we want to talk about, well, where's the next level? What are we going to uptick now? So we'll have a little more discussion about that in a little bit.
Thank you.
Are there any questions about the treasurer's report? So can we have a motion to accept the report?
I have a quick question. Did we ever find out if you got reimbursement from the city to also fund the movie? Because there was talk about that happening.
No, I didn't see the revenues coming from the city. Or it was from press. There was a revenue from press, and the rest was fundraising. So
we followed up. And we have not heard, haven't gotten a response yet, but we are expecting a reimbursement for the movie night, and then also hopefully national night out, which is going to put us above, it's going to put us in a good position compared to the previous year.
What's your money about it?
Cost of the, total cost of the, are you talking about the movie night? The movie night is $825, but actually between the fundraising and the $200 contribution from Press Coffee, we made like $20, but there was a negative. The net was positive $20.
And the other one, the?
The national night out was $427.54.
That's what the city gives you?
No. That's what we expended to do national for national.
So the city is going to refund some of that money back or all of it?
We apply. There are discretionary funds, and we apply for that, and we're waiting to find out whether it's been approved.
Okay, interesting. Thank you.
Yeah, and just to clarify, we're looking to make sure it's all correctly. The fundraising that we do for the movie group is not for the movie night. Our fall fundraising. It does pay for the movie night, but it's our fall fundraiser.
that we decide what to use it for. So we're asking the city to reimburse us because they have funds for that kind of thing. So just to make it clear, fundraiser is just a fall fundraiser.
Any other questions about the current treasurer report? See if I can have a motion to accept in a second.
Motion to accept.
All in favor?
Aye.
All right, I'm going to give a quick president's report, which until, I don't know, 48 hours ago was actually kind of calm and quiet. So the executive committee met 2 weeks ago for the first time, and we started to set some of our priorities. We did a lot of general work in terms of how we're going to set up our office protocols. You know, we had an office. But a lot of it was really talking about our priorities. And I think they carry over from what they've been before, but they're also based on what we're seeing, what we see on Facebook, what we hear here, what kind of questions people send to us by email. And so I'm just going to throw out the big ones, and then we can talk about other priorities that you want on our radar. Because we've not finalized anything, we'll take that back to the executive committee in February. And then we can continue talking about each priority as a membership. So the big one that we've noticed is just what seems to be the increase of crime. I think we feel less and less safe. We feel our property is less and less safe. So we're trying to find out what can we do about that. I probably should send that around if everyone hasn't seen it. I don't know how many people here check on Facebook. Can I just have a quick show of hands? How many people here monitor what we do on Facebook? I put up a link to one of the crime trackers that the San Antonio Police Department uses. It's up on their webpage. And you can look at the types of incidents that are being called in on a weekly basis. You can even sign up, and they will email you if you want it on a daily basis, weekly, or monthly basis. So in looking at that, what I noticed is we really don't have a lot of violent crime, but we have a lot of vandalism sort of crime. We have these petty thefts sort of crime. And even that is not as much as it seems when we're talking to each other or when we look on Facebook. It's not being reported. It's not being reported on their tracker. So either there's a higher incidence or a feeling of it, or things are happening and not being reported, or it just feels unsafe to us because we're hearing a lot more about it than we used to. So I think that's going to be an ongoing conversation at our membership meetings for the next few months, just to figure out what we can do to make ourselves feel safer. And I think tracking, feel free to go to that website and look at it and see whether anything you might have experienced has been reported, and making sure that they are giving the right information is one way. But another way is to be able to work with the police. And they offer several programs. I know we've tried to get a class here so that it's called COPS, is that right, Erin?
Citizens on Patrol.
So it sort of talks to us about setting up a patrol. But there are other things that can be done. They have other classes. And even if we don't set one up here in the neighborhood, citizens can sign up for it. They have them regularly. And I'm glad to see Kelsey here. We put her a little bit on the spot. Kelsey's going to sign up to take a ride along with the police so that she can kind of see what's it like to be a policeman and what's it like to make those calls. That's offered to every citizen. You can just simply sign up on that. So, Kelsey, have you signed up yet? Do you know when you're going to do that?
I have not. I have to wait until I have it.
So I'm going to encourage more people to do that. And if you'd like to volunteer to help us track crime, to help us figure out what to do about the safety issues, we can form a small committee. And maybe you can take a ride with Kelsey and some policemen, or maybe you can go visit a precinct. There are several programs, so we'll be writing about that in the newsletter. We did a short piece on it in the last newsletter. This next coming newsletter, we plan to have a longer piece so you can see what's possible.
Tap on, just so we don't lose the idea, what this membership had discussed last year after the war analyzed the crime data, and we found a pattern that crimes were happening in the morning between 10 and 12 on certain days. And so the idea was
that we would form a citizens on patrol class and tailor it to what the data said. When do we need to be out patrolling the neighborhood? We never were able to get that class together, but Claudia's absolutely right. We don't have to do it as a neighborhood association. We can take the class individually. But in order for us to be a recognized COP, which I think is important for us to take the class before we patrol, because the class teaches you the do's and don'ts of citizen patrolling, we need people to take that class. That would be fabulous.
So we'll continue to promote that in our newsletter on Facebook so that you have that information on a regular basis. So hopefully people will sign up for something and you'll let us know. Like us. Obviously, the other major issue for us is development in our neighborhood. And we're going to talk about that through the Vacant Building Program presentation today, and hopefully have some sort of presentation regarding development for all our membership meetings so that we can sort of see, so that you're informed on how things happen in neighborhoods. There's also a bond program coming up. I hope to invite someone from that to come and talk to us about what that means for this neighborhood. I know that in the District 1 report, Jay has a little bit of an update on that and how it's going to affect us. And then there's one other development issue. Oh, the CCR. So we did submit that letter, I think, in the last meeting, and you'll see that in the minutes. We said that we were editing it and that we would send it off. We did. We know it's in the hands of the councilman, and Jay's going to update us on what that process is like in a few minutes. And then we just talked about budgeting and memberships. And fundraising for our budgeting, our treasurer's report in the future. So the way we've done the treasurer's report in the past is really it's been sort of something that the executive committee works on. We sort of have information come to us on a monthly basis. What we want to do is present to you a yearly budget this time. This is going to be our annual budget. This is what we're striving for in terms of expenses as well as income. And we'd like to have a discussion about that. And so you can tell us, well, I think you're spending too much on this or not enough on that. So I can tell you right now, we spend close to $1,200 a year on social events. And that's almost half of our income. So again, social events were a priority for us, and I think it's really helped bring them together. So I think we want to talk about how do we ensure that they continue and how do we make it sustainable in addition to doing some of the other things that we want to do. So for instance, the charrette that I've talked about, we know that that comes with a cost. It's about $1,500. I think we can negotiate that with the AIA a bit because we are a neighborhood association, but they will also help us fundraise. And Jay will talk maybe a little bit about CCPF funds so everybody knows about that. That's what we were talking about, the city reimbursing us for movie night out and the national night outs. But maybe this time we put some of that money to a charrette. And the charrette would be to help us decide, well, what kind of development is proper for this neighborhood? What should our SCD standards say now? What kind of changes do we want to make? And so this would bring professionals to the neighborhood to help us craft that. I think that's it on development and fundraising. But some of the other little things that we need help on, Facebook. I didn't know that I would have to monitor Facebook so much. And Elizabeth Allen just walked out, right? Well, I look at it and I think, you know, everybody's grown up. People self-monitor, and for a great part, they do. They do self-monitor. And it feels like it's on the cusp of getting out of hand, but everybody reins it in. And so I don't want to over-monitor, but Elizabeth Allen has been really the one person doing it. So we need more people to
There's
help.
Been more. There's a few more. There's a few more, but yeah. We need
I know she gets pained. Let me put it this way. I know she gets pained by people because I think she's visible, and I know I'm getting pained by things. And by pained, I mean people have different levels of sensitivity about the discussion that's going on. I'm a little more relaxed and liberal and willing to let people kind of work it out themselves. But I do not tolerate somebody being called, I don't want profanity. I use it, but I would never use it on Facebook myself. And we had an incident like that this week, and I did delete that person from our membership list. And so we will do that. And what I'd like this group to do, and I talked to Tammy about this, and thank you, Tammy, for agreeing to help really look at our Facebook policies and maybe tweaking them, revising them. How do we make people really read them and pay attention to them so that we can enforce things a little bit more easily? And how do we train people who are monitoring to know what is it you should say to someone? How do you stop someone without them trolling you back? Please. That will happen. So, volunteers for that, please contact us through the AVNPA email. And then Colton Powell. Colton. So, Colton is our newsletter guy. He's the one who distributes everything. And we need more block captains, is that right? You want to talk a little bit about what a block captain does and what the process is?
Sure. So, every month, I send Claudia delivers the newsletters. I package them up for the block captains. And so, depending upon the assignment that the block captain takes on, it's anywhere from 15 to 90 newsletters that they distribute. And those are broken up based mainly on streets that people live on, but there are a few like Ashby and then Hess and Kremkow that Italians now decided to take on. Businesses along North Flores is a small assignment, but there are a few that are open that are definitely in need that have gone vacant. That some people have either moved out of the neighborhood or have taken on responsibilities that no longer allow them to be a block captain. So if you're interested, you can email me at powell.colton@gmail.com, or you can reach me on my phone at 719-930-7466 and ask about the assignments that are open and I guess what those entail. And I think we're open to chopping those up if you're only able to take on a bit of one. Usually just before the week. So at the moment, with the open, or with the blocks that are open at the moment, I still have those newsletters at home. But ideally, I think you get them out a few days in advance.
That has to be cool because we deliver them a little bit late. We had a little hiccup with Kinko's. They, I guess, weren't expecting that they'd be dealing with a new person. And so they called to the next board member, they called Aaron, and then they lost them. So, which all seem connected to me. But anyway, we got there. So thank you for are there any questions of us? And I'm sorry I'm rushing through this, but I want to get to a discussion about the Vacant Building Program and a couple of properties in our neighborhood. But before we do that,
I just have a comment on that on the crime issue. I know sometimes when something petty happens, we just go, we don't call it in. I just want to
I think it does. I think we should be calling in. We should call things in. So if you've had a theft, if you've had some form of vandalism, call it in because it does matter.
One of the things that we observed, which is interesting, and I'm sorry if you live on a street with an alley, but streets on the alleys were two-thirds of the crimes happened on streets with alleys, that particularly home theft. So that's the kind of thing that we're looking for when we look at the state, and it definitely helps when you call in because they will all get more accurate picture of what's happening.
And I'm glad you brought up alleys because there are some programs that we can do to make alleys more fun, more livable for us, and it cuts back on crime. So that will be some of the things that we'll be talking about, and then the technical committee doesn't know that yet, but that's one of the things I'm going to charge Dylan. If you're on the technical committee, can you just raise your hand? I don't know who's here. Okay, great. So, the technical committee, if you'd like to join that, it's a fun group, I think. If there's a request for rezoning, if there's an issue with a property, we ask them to go out, take a look at it, and advise the executive committee, give us a recommendation, and we're going to see them in action tonight because they have a case that they're bringing forward to us. All right. Do you want to talk about the District 1 report?
Good evening, I'm Jake Jitsky. I'm Chief of Staff of Councilman Trevino. Happy New Year to everybody, and really are starting off the year right with this many folks, including two other neighborhood presidents, Betty Eckert from Almost Park Terrace and Cynthia Spielman from Beacon Hill. So you really hit a home run this month. The more the merrier, right? Just to piggyback on what was just discussed with regard to crime, the councilman just held a coffee with the councilman this past weekend at Kenwood Senior Center in Almost Park Terrace. Chief McManus was there for about an hour to discuss crime and some issues that are going on in town. Property crime is definitely a concern and a problem. It is up. It always tends to spike around the holidays, and then it starts to ebb a little bit after the new year. We have a liaison that's a former SAPD officer who I'd love to put in contact with. He does personal and kind of neighborhood crime safety seminars, and he presents to neighborhoods talking about how you can be safe individually, how you can protect your car, your home, what you can do. So if that's of interest, let me know, and I'd love to set that up. He can tailor his presentation. It's 20 to 40 minutes, depending on what your needs are. Also, we can help connect you with your safe officer or a safe officer. I know Officer Bigler is awfully busy, but part of what safe officers do is a home audit or the home safety inspection. So they can walk your property with you, look at your doors, your windows, overgrown shrubs, interior lighting, exterior lighting, make recommendations on how your property could be safer. So if we can help facilitate that, by all means, let us know. In fact, you mentioned ride-along. The COP program is fabulous. We can try to create a regional program where I contact Beacon Hill, Monta Vista, to see if there's a pool of more folks that would be involved in taking the classes. And part of that experience is a ride-along. The councilman just did his third annual ride-along on New Year's Eve. So every holiday, either Christmas Eve or New Year's Eve, since he's been on council, he has done an overnight ride-along with SAPD, and it's very eye-opening to him. He gets to see firsthand what's going on, what the officers face overnight. So he's very much attuned to some of the concerns and problems that are going on because he's been in the car with an officer experiencing it. So however we can help you get involved with PD, experience those things, learn more, protect yourselves, protect your community, let us know. We're happy to facilitate. One thing that Claudia mentioned is the NCE review for Alta Vista. Last year, Councilman Trevino submitted a CCR to review the Beacon Hill at the request of Beacon Hill and working with the Neighborhood Association, working with them to review their NCE. That is a much longer process than I think Cynthia probably wanted to see, but it's a very comprehensive review of the NCD, working with city staff, our office, and the neighborhood to really chart a course forward. These things have been in place now for 10 plus years, and the nature of development has changed, and so the nature of the NCDs must evolve as well.
Can you remind us what those acronyms are?
NCDs, Neighborhood Conservation District. CCR is a council consideration request. That's the mechanism that council members have to create ordinances. So the city manager and the mayor can put anything on the council agenda when they want to. Council members have got to get four additional council members to support their initiative, and then it goes to governance, and then it goes to council if approved. So that's the mechanism that the councilman had to use to get support from his colleagues to, in Beacon's example and your example, review the city policy. As a result of both of those CCRs, and I apologize for the acronyms, it's city government, there's a lot of acronyms, the city has decided to review all of the NCDs throughout the city. I believe there's 10. Many of them are located in District 1 and the historic districts of San Antonio. So what we're going to push for, I just haven't heard from planning yet what their plan is, but we are going to push, since you made the request, that you're the first one reviewed in that new process of reviewing all of them. They're a big chunk of the way through Beacon Hills, so that should hopefully come to fruition fairly soon, and then our goal is to push the city to really crack open the Alta Vista NCD to start reviewing it as the first on the list. So that was a positive for us in that the work that we've done with your neighborhoods has resulted in actually the city wanting to revisit all of these NCDs to improve them. With regard to the bond, I just wanted to let you know the bond package went to council last week for approval. It was approved to go to the ballot this May for your approval, my approval, all of our approvals. But for Alta Vista, there is a significant amount of, and all of the urban core of San Antonio, kind of Alta Vista, Beacon Hill, Five Points, Monte Vista, within a mile radius of the intersection of Woodlawn and San Pedro is approximately $34 million worth of bond package. So there's $1.8 million to further the master planning and execution of that at San Pedro Springs. The Fred Road corridor, which we worked with Beacon Hill and the business community on Fred Road to really advocate for and push, is a $9 million package, which will help turn from the Five Points intersection to Woodlawn into a complete street, more pedestrian friendly, some more on-street parking amenities, improved crosswalks. The Five Points intersection is also on the bond at $3 million. So really that corridor is gonna get a transformative makeover. You were talking about public safety. The central police substation with Park Police is slated to be built, if approved, just south of SAC, between downtown and SAC on San Pedro. So just by virtue of that project being executed, and that's a $20 million project, you would see a lot more police presence up and down San Pedro, because that is where they would be going to and from. So that is gonna have a very positive effect on crime in this area. There's a $9 million pedestrian mobility package for District 1. Now, not all of that will be spent within this area, but that means more sidewalks, sidewalk gap fills. And then finally, the San Pedro Quikrete project, the park component, which is a linear park. You may have seen they're already starting to do work on the drainage component downtown. San Pedro Springs Park and the Creekway right by Little Italy is really the founding of San Antonio, to where the first Alamo was. And so it's important that we really focus dollars and attention on that area, especially as we celebrate our birthday. So those are some of the things that you'll see in the bond. We encourage you to just Google 2017 San Antonio bond. You'll get a link to the bond package. You can see all the programs. There'll be six items on the ballot. And get educated. There's a lot of transformative stuff, and it's a lot of, as mayor, city manager are calling it, kind of back to basic stuff. It's a lot of infrastructure. District 1 has a great need, and so we're happy to see 25% of the bond is, you know, between citywide projects and district projects being spent in District 1. So, yes?
Who's on the bond committee for District 1?
Well, there were 15 members that were on, three members per five categories of committee. I can send you the list down if you'd like. They met regularly in the committee bond meetings, but the councilman in our office conducted three what we call block parties, where we got the committee members out on the weekend, and that was part and parcel for them to participate. Was we told them, we're gonna do these events, but we're gonna have you come. We want the community to come meet you, talk about projects, advocate for the needs of your neighborhood. And so we did that. Our first one was at San Pedro Springs. We did one on West End Park, and then one at Shear Hills Ridgeview Walking Trail, to really try to hit the different corners of the district to get those committee members out into the community to hear from you. So I know a number of you did come, and we appreciate that. Yes?
I was on the Arroyo committees 6 years ago when we first started the Arroyo linear parks that you're talking about coming around.
Yes.
San Pedro Creek was included in it. And there was already money for that being the park. Now, we're asking for more bond money for, how is it being funded? Because I'm kind of confused about the funding that they had before, the linear parks, and now the new funding for the same project.
What the linear creekways is more than just the San Pedro Creek.
Yeah, I understand, but San Pedro Creek is one of them.
It is, and I would have to look to see how that money was spent, where the new investment is. Again, there's a big chunk of it that's drainage that's downtown, and that means from where the dam is right by Christopher Columbus Park south, that component is being redone in terms of drainage, and then they're gonna build an amphitheater right across from the Alameda. It's gonna be akin to the more park-like version of the Riverwalk without the commercial development right on the water.
So some of that money that was previously allotted to it is currently for projects that are happening right now. So if you were to go to there, and I know because I was there this morning, there was a huge traffic backup. They are currently working on San Pedro Creek right by Fox Tech. So a lot of that money was...
Yeah, my question was about the funding.
Right, so that funding, so what I'm trying to answer is what you asked, what happened to that funding? It's being implemented now. So the bond is for the additional improvements along the creek that go all the way from basically where Camarón Street is, all the way down to, you know, near where the Bear County building, near Alamo Street.
Okay, so you're not expecting members?
No.
Okay, so how do we know that the funding, like, went like the way you said?
It's been in the paper, that's how I know about it.
It's been in the Express newspaper?
It's been in the paper, it's on city websites. So what I can do is post some of this information on our Facebook page. Do you come to our Facebook page?
Not sure.
Okay, so we'll figure out how we get that information to...
And majority of those monies for that project are not city funds. The San Antonio River Authority and Bear County took the lead in that project. The city had a very, very, very small role in funding those improvements. It is now this bond money that the city is going to invest dollars to approve by the board. And just go to the website, Bear County website, and you'll get a breakdown of all the money that has been spent in the different phases.
And I'll give you my card, I'll be happy to do any research, answer specific questions. But that's typically, especially when we're talking about large-scale drainage projects and the creek waste projects, are those with the parks project on top?
It was just kind of confusing because I was on the Arroyo Creek projects, and then with the new funding, that's why I don't know, whatever.
Yeah, they
tend to get bigger.
Yeah, they tend to piggyback on one another, again, especially with drainage projects, because they have to be phased. But again, I'll give you my contact information. Be happy to research that for you.
Chair, real quick, could you forward that breakdown that you read to us so it could be part of the minutes for the next meeting?
Certainly. Certainly. For the bond, that is, right?
Yes, but what did you just finish reading?
Most definitely. Any other questions? I know you've got an action-packed agenda tonight. So.
All right, thank you, Jay.
Thank you.
So I'm very pleased that John Stevens, who is the program manager for the Vacant Building Program, is here tonight. I talked to John about this back in October, and he had agreed, so I was happy he was coming. I'm even happier now because we have a property that we can talk about how the Vacant Building Program can apply to it. Just a quick little background. I started hearing about the Vacant Building Program a long time ago. That was when Councilman Diego was our councilperson. And he and I had talked about it, and at that time, Alta Vista was supposed to be part of that program. And so I was a little sad when it got cut back and really was only going to be enforced in historic districts and around military bases. So I'm excited that it's come back to, that it's been expanded, come back to the original vision. And I want to thank Councilman Trevino and the other councilmen who were really pushing forward on this and voted that it should be expanded. And of course, that meant a lot more work for John, but here he is to tell you what it's all about.
All right, thank you all for listening to me tonight. Thank you for inviting me here. I work in the Office of Historic Preservation. I manage the city's vacant building registration program. We're very excited about the expansion. I think there's a lot of great opportunity to do some good in this neighborhood and then a lot of the surrounding neighborhoods. This expansion doesn't just impact Alta Vista. It impacts Beacon Hill, a lot of the corridors, the north-south corridors, and major thoroughfares. You know, we're incorporating a lot more area and filling a lot of gaps that kind of fell outside the program. Really, the goal is to make movement on long vacant buildings, unmaintained structures. A couple of those within your neighborhood are 441 West Summit, directly across the field here at the, you know, as you go up the parking lot, you can see a long boarded building there, and it's an opportunity. So we will be working with that property owner to try to create a positive outcome. Others are 505 West Woodlawn and 503 West Kings Highway. At a very high level, I want to talk with you about how this works. You know, it is not a quick process. It is a lot of effort. It's a lot of relationship building. We work with property owners. No property owner is just dragged to court. We give property owners 90 days in which to register their property with our office after we provided them with notice. At that point in time, so after we provide notice, they have 90 days to register. They submit a reasonable plan for correcting violations of the standard of care. So all the maintenance, exterior maintenance issues with the building that you would anticipate, you know, a responsible property owner to maintain a building to. And at that point, we work with them to ensure that they actually commit to and follow that plan and resolve the issues. And so I would be your point of contact with all properties like that. They have to be vacant for 30 or more days. But I would like you all to know who I am, know our goals, be able to understand how the program works, and come to me. You know, there are ways for you to anonymously report buildings on our website. So if there's a, you know, a property on your block, I want to hear from you. We will do surveys of the neighborhood regularly. We'll be out in this neighborhood. Now, I live fairly close to this neighborhood. You know, we're going to spend time here, but we won't be here as often as you all are. And we really need that level of you know, cooperation with the neighborhood. So please go ahead and, you know, always know that you can go to our website and report a structure. You can also always call our offices. I am personally responsible for this area. We have a team of six. Thankfully, with the expansion, we were able to get some more staff. I have now a team of six, and we're over 109 square miles. And the way we've broken it out is that I will be responsible for Alta Vista, Beacon Hill, downtown, most of this kind of area of District 1. And so if you see anything in the community that you're concerned with, I'm happy to be a point of contact, and I'm happy to try to direct you to resources. But in a nutshell, we're trying to make change in situations where oftentimes there hasn't been much progress. So I'm using that property across the street here as a prime example. You know, that is an opportunity for us. Traditionally, if buildings like that were kept secured, they were essentially deemed to be within compliance of our property maintenance code. So we're trying to be a little bit more assertive, a little bit more proactive, and we're trying to create that change. I want to be able to answer any questions that you have, but I want to give you a real quick primer on how this works. And I do want to emphasize that it's not a silver bullet. It takes a lot of effort. It takes a lot of relationship building. In many instances, many of these people may not have really been pushed to do much for many, many years. You know, or in many instances, there's ownership issues with the property. Where an owner might be dead, or you know, there are a lot of complicating factors. And we've got to work through a lot of those issues. But I can tell you we're very committed to solving the few problems that are in your community. Thankfully, you have a very stable, very strong neighborhood with a lot. You know, I see, obviously, progress. And I don't anticipate that you're going to have an enormous number of problem structures, but we want to be there for the ones that you have. And I also want to explain that we'll be working both on buildings where there's no activity and where there's construction activity. So throughout that timeline of someone completing a project, we're going to be monitoring it, we're going to be in contact with them. You know, that does not mean that if there are construction stops and small issues, those things are going to be natural in any project. But I want to stress that we are there to be a point of contact with the owner and to make sure that we communicate well with them and that we're available to you all if there are any questions. So that is the very short intro I have for you, and I just want to open it up if there's any questions.
I have a question.
Sure.
What are the mechanisms between your office, code enforcement, building permits, things like that, because there seems to be, there has been a disconnect. Is this going to change that disconnect?
So you say there is a disconnect. First, this is not applied in this area, so there hasn't been a disconnect to date. There is the opportunity, as you mentioned, that there are three different areas of the city, actually more than that, that are often working on similar properties at the same time. And it's our role to coordinate. One of the things that I do not do, I ensure that the building owners obtain permits. I don't do permit inspections. A small team of 6 out of 190 square miles, that's the size tank for. So we are not the people going to properties to do. We do inspections of whether or not the building meets the standard of care, but we're not doing construction-related or permitting-related inspections. And so we ensure that property owners obtain them, and we try to make sure that we alert, that we communicate with those offices. As far as code is concerned, if it is a vacant structure, generally the interpretation is the property maintenance code does not apply if the building is secured. So if it is a secure vacant building, the example being this one across the street, I'm sorry if I'm using that, if people aren't aware of it.
Can you speak it a little bit louder?
I'm sorry, I woke up without my voice this morning, so I apologize.
Clearly, you're talking about the one on San Pedro?
I'm talking about this building, if you're right out the parking lot on the summit. The corner house right here. I'm sorry, I will try to speak louder, my voice is pretty much dead today. So that property there, the traditional interpretation of our code is that is in compliance and that it is secure. And so we are trying to take a different approach to that. So for those properties, there should be no confusion. Those are well within my realm. They're not dangerous premises. They're not dangerous premises. They're not issues where we're applying all aspects of the code. We've agreed that those are properties that I'll be working on to address. Now, there will be properties that are dangerous premises, and I will coordinate the code on those properties.
Yeah, the specific reason I asked that was because of 503.
Yes.
So in the age of alternative facts, they have applied alternative facts, and when you watch it long enough and you're keeping in touch, you start to realize that they're not being entirely honest with all of the units of the city who are dealing with them. So I want to see you guys be able to do your job.
There's always an opportunity to answer shop. When you have 12,000 employees and 38 departments, we see that happen.
And they've been awesome. And the people who have come out, the code enforcement officers, that's no criticism of them. I know that their job is difficult.
Absolutely. Yeah. So, as an example, for 503, both my staff, myself, and code enforcement have been out there. We're both coordinating, speaking with their managers. We know what we're doing. We have an understanding. We're all in touch with the property owner.
Yeah, we're finally seeing some success today.
And so that's both, the result of code's action and the result of our, making that contact. And so we'll continue to coordinate. They're going to continue to inspect. We will continue to inspect. But I'm confident that is not going to be an issue.
It's looking good today.
With that being said, if I may, John and I don't sit too far from each other. I'm the zoning and permitting supervisor for the city of San Antonio, and we are coordinating a lot better nowadays since he doesn't sit too far from me. And if he needs help with the property, he lets me know, and if I need help with the property, I let him know.
What's your name?
My name is Michael Uresti. I apologize.
Michael Uresti.
I'm the zoning and permitting supervisor. And I work closely with John, and he helps me out a lot. And he has been helping out with this new program he has. And we're really excited because that's going to help us get a lot of these buildings back up to code and off our books. So if you have any questions, you can always call John, and we can get the coordination going.
So to answer your question, we're definitely. And that is part of the reason it's important that. And I stress this, and it might sound silly, but it's important that you contact staff. I can contact, I will know well whether or not this building is a potential dangerous premise that needs to be alerted to code. Or Michael will know if it's a property that, potentially is in my, more the realm of my program. But we need to have that coordination with the community.
So do you mean, rather than use an app to record anything, suggest to
Well, you can report things through 311. I can tell you that most things you report through 311 that are code-related are going to go to code. And so I would ask personally that if it is a vacant structure, that you reach out to me directly. There are some things we can improve with 311, and I need work to do that. But I can tell you that it will come to me at a higher percentage if you reach out to me directly, and we'll get to work on it faster.
Do you have a contact
number? I do. Sorry, just real quick. My phone number is 207-7999. I'm going to leave a stack of business cards with Claudia. And my number is also on the website. And you can report structures at any time anonymously through a link on the website. And my email, in case you want it, is john.stevens3@sanantonio.gov. So, if that's all.
How do you spell Stevens?
S-T-E-V-E-N-S.
And we'll put all of this up on our website so that you can go to it easily.
Yeah, it's a lot to consume right now, but I will definitely follow up and provide Claudia with some information that you can share in a brochure on the program, and then feel free to follow up with me with any questions. Yes, Liz?
Do you maintain a list on the website of properties that are registered so that we can check before calling them in to see if it's already on there?
We do. And it is up. This is an awkward time of year for us because technically properties are required, once they register the first time, they're required to register by January 31st of each year. So we're in this kind of like little holding pattern where we're waiting for the registrations to come in, and then we'll be pushing owners who failed to register, that did in past years. So right now what you'll see is the list from December before the program expanded. But in the future months, there's an inventory link on the website that you can check. But especially if you see change or negative change, report it. Just because it's on that page doesn't mean that I've seen the property in the last several weeks. I mean, we're trying to be vigilant and present, but that's not something we can always do. Yes, sir.
Are you doing vacant buildings and houses? You're not doing the vacant lots?
No. It relates only to vacant structures. So vacant lots are code enforcement's role, and so that would be, you should report those to 311 if they're overgrown.
Jim, you have your own page on the OHP component of the website. So that's a way for you to go directly. Do you know what the URL is for them?
Oh, I believe it's sanantonio.gov/vacant-buildings.
And then can you let everybody know, since the program has just evolved, what it was and now what it is and how it's grown? I think they might.
Like so that. Initially, this program was launched covering the central business district, the city's historic districts, and areas within a half mile of active military bases. And historic landmarks. Now the expansion really is much broader. We're adding neighborhood conservation districts and a half mile buffer around them. All of the city initiated TERS, which are tax increment reinvestment zones. I wouldn't anticipate that anybody here needs to know what that is, but they're large areas that include much of the east side and much of the west side, and then a half mile buffer around those. The defense base authorities like Port Support and Brooks and the area around them. And so those NCDs and those TERS, that expansion is 74 square miles. So we cover most of District 1 now, much of the east side, the near west side, the Mission Historic District and a half mile buffer around it, and then the areas around Lackland, the Port, and Brook City Base. So we're north of Olmos Park Terrace, basically down to the Missions, and then much of the near east and west sides. So we cover 20% of the city at this point, which 20% sounds small, but 109 square miles is significant growth for us. So we're still surveying those areas. We have done initial surveys of Alta Vista, and so we're going to get started sending out the notices to those properties, they will have just gone out. So the building owners that we've identified thus far will have been notified over the next, they should have already received the notices, but if they haven't, it'll be the next few days.
John, can you point to any examples of success stories that might give us an idea of what it's going to turn into?
And so one of the primary successes and one of our first successes that I like to refer to is 645 East Park in Tobin Hill. I refer to it not because it's the most recognizable property, but on Park Avenue and Park and St. Mary Street, there was a very long, you know, a dilapidated property. It's been sitting in that condition for 10 years. The grass when I first went there was literally above my waist. Most of the windows were open, and it had been owned by a military member who has been overseas and a buy-and-hold investor for a long time. You know, we worked with him, we gave him an opportunity. He chose to sell the property, which is one of the avenues that people can take if they're not willing to make repairs. Because under this program, we will provide them an extension if they're willing to list the property for fair market value, which that owner did. And it was purchased by someone who renovated the home. It's a very pretty home. It's a very significant change on a very, you know, it was a hard corner. It was a very prominent house as you're going up a significant street. At this point, 180 buildings that were once subject to the ordinance are now exempt. So in the course of the 2 years, we've worked with about 500 properties in total, and about 180 of them are now exempt. There are lots of, you know, examples of buildings becoming occupied or being renovated to the point where they meet our standard of care. And for single-family homes, they're exempt once they meet the standard of care. So that's another important point, is that if there is a well-maintained vacant home in your neighborhood, or if you're thinking about selling your home, that is outside of the scope of my program. We are not to spend resources on properties where the property owner's, you know, upkeeping the home.
John, real quickly, a lot of homes in this neighborhood have car garages or granite flats that have been converted to apartments. Will these structures be subject to this policy?
So, if technically any structure can be a part of the policy, but we're looking at structures like, if it's a significant garage apartment, then it's something that we would pursue. And if it is in a state that needed to be addressed. Now, it is important to recognize that we are a small team with a very specific focus. We're not taking on the entire code enforcement role. You know, we're not doing, you know, grass or some of those things that you might think of as traditional code enforcement. But if there's a real problem structure, report it to me and we can at least discuss it, and we'll go from there. But if it's just if it's a carport that needs a coat of paint, that's probably not what we're not going to pursue.
I'm talking about structures that have been converted to be household units.
Yeah.
That's what I'm referring to.
Yes, then it would.
But a lot of these back garages are just on slats, and not even built right, so I don't know, people turn into garages. The gas station, the old gas stations, abandoned gas stations, I know that there's a special.
I'm sorry, sir. Can you say anything? There's a couple of points here. What do we do when somebody can't or won't take action? I skipped over the enforcement aspect of this ordinance, mostly because it's not that's not our goal. Our goal is not to pursue people in a punitive way, it's to work with people. But the reality is, if people fail to comply, there's a risk of municipal court cases being filed against them for all the maintenance issues on the home. Now, we want to work with people as much as possible to prevent that from happening. We try to give people every opportunity to, you know, produce a positive outcome. You have to remember that these are vacant buildings. We're not upending anyone out of their home. We're not, you know, it's not that we're throwing someone's life into turmoil because we're evicting them from their property. That's not what's happening. This is a property that's been vacant for 30 or more days. and they haven't taken action. Oftentimes, they've been vacant for a long time, and we give them an opportunity to come up with a reasonable plan, which can include potentially selling the property. Claudia, am I going over?
We're going to.
Perfect.
Go ahead.
Well, I will be available after this. If you have any questions, I apologize if I wasn't speaking loudly enough. I have no voice. So. But anyway, it's very good.
All of this information on our website, so you know how to contact him very easily and how to monitor and get the leaks in our area. And now that he's here, we as a neighborhood association can help spread that word and keep you up to date on what's going on. I want to talk about 503 West Kings Highway. Can we meet the art committee after the technical committee to take a vote? I would like the technical committee to update us on what's happened with 503 West Kings Highway. And one of the things that John and I did talk about, and so did Mike, is that we can bring a monthly update to the neighborhood association on that property if we need that. So that's one strength about having this program here, is we really have access to information much more easily. So David, would you give the update on what's happened with 503 West Kings Highway?
Okay. So I'm David Vogel, and I'm first man of the neighborhood, Claudia's husband. And as a technical committee person, that's sort of handy, I was asked to look at this one. So 503 West Kings Highway is under construction. I don't know how long it's been vacant, but I got a handy summary sheet here from our code zoning and permitting supervisor, Michael Duresti, who introduced himself earlier. So the debris has been removed. I understand a new fence was up today. Plan reviewers visited the property, reviewed the status of the NCD requirements, and it appears that it complied when they submitted plans for renovation, and NCD enforcement will check it out as it's built to make sure it still complies. Contractor has been notified the exterior must be replaced with stucco. Contractor on site will work with the crew. Owner has to, oh, fence is done, sorry. Storage pod will be removed from the street by 26 tomorrow. The dumpster will be emptied and moved off the right-of-way by the weekend. And then we'll be checking the status of the property daily with visits by the code officer, looking for debris piles, ensuring the work site is properly secured, and that they follow the NCD requirements.
And just for context, this is what it looked like before it was stripped and gutted. This is as of Wednesday, I believe. Today is Wednesday, but Monday. So this, that fence will make
this file, is this the King's Highway front?
Uh-huh. Yeah.
Yes.
So
it's changed a lot since I was there. When I was there last, the existing framing was on the facade, and the existing windows on King's Highway were still framed. There is an NCD requirement for window openings on the frontage, and that would be, in this case, on West King's Highway frontage. So our NCD standards aren't very extensive. They're not requiring them to rebuild the house the way, the apartment building the way it used to be.
Yeah, because
it's one of the reasons we want to look at revising the NCD standards.
Yeah, David, because in this specific case, a very, very small part of it is actually frontage on West Kings.
Right.
Where you see it is when you come up from Summit of West Kings Highway, and that's our gateway into that section of the neighborhood. And you see this big ugly, you know, and so that's one example of an NCD requirement that needs to be.
So this neighborhood is what? It's not historical, but it's
neighborhood conservation.
We're conservation,
mm-hmm. And we have a standard that's a page and a half.
Yeah, which is interesting. So I'm glad to see that they will be required to skin it with stucco. Is that because of our NCD? Because when I looked at the NCD, I thought, oh, this does not have enough teeth.
The NCD does talk about keeping materials in kind.
I don't remember what the exact wording is.
Okay, good. That's positive, because I think that adds a lot to the character of this particular.
But I will say, I think.
It says you can use different materials.
See.
I think that it's not as enforceable to say stucco, but I think in this case, because they're trying to keep the neighborhood in peace, we're able to push that a little bit more, but our NCD needs to restrict that.
Okay, thank you.
Because it's only required, I mean, it's not required, it's not permitted.
Well, who stops them? Because I talked to the construction manager, and they're originally were going to put up siding. And then at some point over the last, you know, 4 or 6 weeks, they switched to stucco, apparently tonight. Who tells them to do that?
We stopped them, sir.
Okay.
Code enforcement, the zoning and permitting team working along with the code enforcement and working with John.
Okay.
So.
Was it a happenstance you happened to pull by and you saw that they were about to do
something? Well, no, we did get some calls on it. Okay. And we had gotten some calls that it was, you know, dirty, it wasn't secure, that it was being a nuisance for like the children in the school area around there.
Right.
So what we did is we sent the officer out there, zoning and permitting, and the normal code enforcement officer, so we could ensure that we resolved all issues. And what we did was put together a comprehensive plan, working with John and code and land development to ensure we got everything taken care of. And if you look at the NCD requirements for the Alta Vista, under the building materials, it says rehabilitation. The building materials so match the existing structure and scale and proportion and or profile.
Mm-hmm.
So that's why we said you gotta do it in stucco.
Okay, so if we see things that are happening, we should call you,
yes,
and
sir.
Say, because if they put it up, y'all aren't going to tell them to take it down.
They put it up, you call us, and we'll go ahead and cite them for being in violation of the NCD requirements and building outside the scope of the permit, if the permit doesn't allow it, sir.
And people are involved in the made to break things down if that
works. Okay. So, I also was in the sheet, which is what the developer was told when they got approval of NCD. And it does include in here, it says, regarding building materials, regulations do not prohibit changing the materials when done comprehensively. So.
Okay, hopefully they will cover the building comprehensively. That's,
we're going to be working to ensure they adhere to the NCDs and to keep it as much as they can using this code in compliance of what it should look like before as much as we can.
Mm-hmm. Great.
All right, I do want to move because we do have to, we have a request to rezone some properties, and we do need to take a membership vote on this. So, David, if you could be concise about.
So, the applicant, Lynn Warren, is here. She's a resident on 424, the one on the right.
No, I'm
sorry.
I live at 430.
430, the one on the left.
I just purchased the house next door at 420.
And she requested that the neighborhood association support her rezoning application. So the committee looked at it, and 430 West Magnolia, the one on the left, sorry. 430 West Magnolia is currently a single family home, and it is zoned currently multifamily 33. So she's requesting to rezone it to R6 to conform with the existing single-family use, and the technical committee thought that was a very good idea. The 424 West Magnolia is currently a duplex and it's deteriorated, and it's, however, it's zoned R6, so to do work on it, to keep it a duplex, she needs to rezone it.
Can you explain what R6 is?
R6 is the zoning designation, which is suitable for single family homes, one dwelling unit.
So she can operate
per lot.
Duplex out there.
Right, you can develop it as a duplex or restore it as a duplex with that zoning. So.
But it historically has been a duplex.
That's yes,
what I was thinking.
It appears to have always
been. The meeting came out today, it was unclear as to actually what the acronym means, first of all. So I didn't go and look at this. That was a sheet back in the background. I remember what the meeting. But so to be clear, the R6 means that it's a single family residence. But in the agenda, it said that it was offered as a duplex or multi-family?
So historically, the property has operated as a duplex. What we mean by that, and from what we can tell from its original, and I did do some research through this in newspaper archives, it appears that it has always been a duplex. It appears that there is an apartment upstairs and an apartment downstairs. Why it's zoned for a single family, we don't know. We think that's just simply a mistake because there are, there's a historical record that shows this has traditionally been rented as a duplex. So when the property owner was trying to get permits to do the right thing, to rehab the building, she wasn't able to get that because it was zoned as a single family and the work she's trying to do is for a duplex. So in order for her to operate this as a duplex, she needs to change the zoning.
So basically what she's doing, she's changing the zoning of both houses to make them rank for both houses?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, and they have to be next to each other. She owns both of them. And because of the overall property size, she's able to do them both on the same zoning application. So the single application that she's filled out is for both of these properties to change.
So we're not flipping the property, we're just recognizing what it really is.
Right, they're really separate cases in our analysis, and that's why I'm presenting that way.
Especially when you look at this, I mean, to think that it's zoned for multifamily 33, which would be a huge complex, I probably there was a mistake,
right.
Is really what I think.
They probably did it for tax purposes.
So the applicant's seeking to rezone the duplex to RN4, and our technical committee wants to support that it be rezoned to RN6. We've talked about that with her, with the applicant. The RM6 would allow the duplex as of right, but it's the least intensive zoning that would allow the duplex. So it would allow fewer units if it were redeveloped or demolished someday than the one that she originally sought. So what we'd like is to recommend that the Neighborhood Association support that it be rezoned RM6, and then once she gets that letter, she would change her request to the zoning commission to go that route. That's the scenario we're supporting. So any questions for me or the applicant?
I move that the Neighborhood Association write a letter in support of the property owner for both rezoning requests, from the R6 or MF33 to R6 and from the RR6 to RM4.
To RM4?
The right way.
I mean, the thinking on our committee was let's support the one that's the least intensive.
Yes, that makes total sense.
The fewest permissible dwelling units that complies with the duplex. And that seems to be kind of the way neighbors want to see redevelopment here.
I second.
Okay.
Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Excellent. Yay. Hey, what's an art committee update? Texas, we have good news.
Sure. Well, I was talking about 504. Seeing that fence go up, I was like,
yes, thank you.
But if you took a look at the newsletter that came out, it was posted on Facebook several days ago, I understand it came out for today, there was an update that is very, very clear. We haven't moved. Jen Koshman, who is also on the committee, is here. It hasn't moved very far forward yet. We're just kind of in our first phase of discussing things.
This is the mural committee.
The mural committee, okay. Yes. The second meeting will be held on, it looks like February 10th. And so we will be brought up to speed on the process that will be used to choose artists, to evaluate artists, so on and so forth for the mural.
Can you just give the context of where the mural is going to be?
The mural that we're discussing, for anyone who's not familiar with that, is the Fulton Street underpass. that's just right down from the Beacon. The railroad goes over it. Twyla Arthur's wonderful mosaic wall extends through that section, and we have funding to go ahead and commission a mural for that underpass. And so that's what we're doing, and we'll be keeping you guys informed as things go forward. There's not a lot to report right now, but we will keep you informed as things move forward. Any questions? I may or may not be able to answer. All right.
What kind of the term for your guys' part?
So I want to go back to our budget very quickly, and I just want to see a show of hands and some ideas. So as I said, the majority of our funds go for social events. So just a quick idea, does everybody still like that? Is that
yay! Yay!
All right. What other things do you think we should be budgeting for?
What happened to the little train depot we had on Wall Street on the tracks on Municipal? We talked about it a long time ago in these meetings, but I don't know.
In what context?
No, I don't think everything ever came up with it, but the building's still there. I mean, there's no project to do.
Would we be interested in having some seminars? We gave an honorarium to somebody who talks about historic gardens and what we can do in our neighborhood for gardening. Something like that. Would we be interested in bringing people in like that? Do we like that? So maybe an educational series. And then thinking about people who come to this.
I'm kind of interested in some neighborhood education, possibly. Tree planting and things like that can really sort of enhance the streetways and the preservation of public right-of-way.
Okay.
So, I mean, I don't know how much that would cost or what kind of labor we have to get together in order to do that, but I'd be interested in seeing some money spent.
Okay. We'll look into what costs might be, and we'll start building that into the budget.
We can also work with saws on that.
Well, and with the city arborist. So, who has already talked about maybe coming out and giving us free treats. So.
And on that note, the total of 26,000
fruit trees
would show up.
The
pearl? Yeah. The pearl. Question of application is where can we put these things in the safe? You don't want to block these or anything like that.
Well, we already have beautification funds, and we've tried to figure out what to do with them. Maybe that's pretty old.
Well, the little island that Breeden and Gramercy by the 503, that needs some assistance.
Right, okay.
So that would be my suggestion. So we have struggled to maintain those islands. And for those that don't know, those islands, the two traffic islands at Keynes and Gramercy, are dedicated to past members of the association who have since passed on. And we maintain those islands in memory of those individuals, but we struggle every year to maintain them. And we try to bring two work days together, and we don't always get enough people, and we have the same people consistently showing up, and it's difficult. So we have those two islands to maintain. Those are ours. The city does not maintain them. And then we also have the Fulton Street underpass area where Twyla Arthur's tile work is. So we are also responsible for maintaining all of that greenery along there. It's a lot of work. So we all need to either show up and help and beautify those areas when those work days can come together, or maybe we can look at spending some money on hiring a maintenance team, because we could do that affordably. And then seasonally, well, it gets done more often so that it doesn't turn into, like those poor cactuses just look terribly sad there after the weeks. So that's just an idea. Maybe we can look at a maintenance.
I didn't know whose those were. So I didn't know they're ours.
They're ours.
Another recommendation I had is for sidewalks. You know, we have a lot of places where we've just got upheaval from roots or from swelling or something like that. You can actually sort of soft cut those diagonal pieces and smooth some of that stuff out. I've seen it done in other cities where they just have maintenance crews from the city come out and they, you know, chop off that little angle piece and sort of smooth out those transitions. So that's something that's fairly cheap and fairly easy to do. We could do it, I suppose, as a neighborhood, or maybe look at something that the city could do.
There's actually a city.
That's what I'm talking about.
So city code maintains that the abutting property owner maintains their sidewalks in good order, but the city does have a cost sharing program for the repair of sidewalks that was initiated last fiscal year and has continued this fiscal year. So I'd be happy to give Claudia the information. She can link to it on your social media and your newsletter and send that out. That's, unfortunately, last year it was very underutilized. There are some neighborhood associations like King William that have a bigger kitty of money that also do their own cost sharing with the residents of the neighborhood. So they were able to leverage those monies to do a lot more, but it's a great way to fix those problem areas that pop up in areas, older areas with lots of mature trees are definitely victims to that happening.
Right, and those can cover like some of the entire property's frontage, right? But if you've just got, you know, one area where you've got a tree growing,
No, that's a different thing. That's Councilman Trevino's pilot program on precast concrete sidewalks. They're almost finished installing those panels, and now the city will be evaluating the poured-in-place traditional sidewalks versus the precast panels. Yes.
So what I understand, the precast panels were for temporary for future construction, but were they going to be permanent?
No, it's permanent.
It's permanent. So the Lavaca Neighborhood Association said that those panels were there in case there's future construction, to be able to remove them without breaking up the whole sidewalk.
Well, that's the benefit of precast panels, is that they connect, right, and are, for lack of a better term, hinged. So if there's work that needs to be done, or if there's swelling, they can move a little bit more than a traditional sidewalk. But then if there's work to be done, a panel can be popped up, do the work, pop it back on.
Well, that's what they're asking, those were permanent. But I understand from the customer that they weren't permanent.
No, the precast panels are a permanent installation.
So I'm going to just move it on, because we're at the end of our meeting.
Is the neighborhood responsible for the posts down by the underpass? Because one of the lights, the one on our side, is falling right here. It looks like it's messed up and it needs to be repaired.
Sounds like that would be a city.
It's in the art
institution. Thank you for pointing that out. Jim, are they saying that there might be some funds for doing some repair on within this project, or repairing the light and things like that?
It's definitely something that we should spend money on before we talk to the city about it.
But it is something that we can mark as part of our meeting budget, and we can have that to our members. So on that note, we're going to have, I'm sorry, Robin, were you saying, may I say something about?
Hi, for those of you who don't know me, my name is Robin Harvey. I'm Communications Director for State Representative Bernal. And I'm really happy to be here. I wasn't expecting to be here because we're all moved up to Austin for the legislative session. And on that note, we're looking for people to represent us at neighborhood associations. We're trying to figure out the best way to do that, and we're about to release a call for volunteers. And Raphael was an intern at our office for a week. And he was wonderful, and it's a great experience for young people who want to get involved and learn how the legislature works. I can give you our office number, which is, we just got a new number, so I don't remember it. 512-463-0532, and you should ask for Anita, who's our chief of staff. And on the note of trying to make the legislative process a little bit less opaque, we're hoping to have a meeting probably towards the end of February, maybe someplace at the Friendly Spot on a Sunday afternoon, to talk about how the legislature works and how you can get involved. I think a lot of people are really craving that kind of information right now. So we'll talk about our agenda, but also just how it works in general. So if you want to talk to me about our agenda, please, I'll stick around for a little bit. So that's it. Thank you.
Robin, could you repeat that number one more time?
Yes. 512-463-0532.
I was going to announce that the executive committee is meeting on February 21st, and we will be talking about the budget. Those meetings are open to everybody, so if you would like to come, you are welcome. I will post where we're going to meet. I don't know yet where we're going. We kind of roam around. Last time we were at my house, we may do that again. But I'll let everyone know, especially on the budget. I think it would be great if people want to listen in or get some more ideas. Any other announcements? Yes.
We run the studios that are down by the train tracks on West Russell and West Craig. We're part of On and Off Fredericksburg Road Studio Tour. How many of y'all have been to the Millworks? It's a cool place if you haven't. Isn't it, guys? It's nuts. We've got about 52 artists that have studios, and it's everything from photographers to installers.
So, excuse me, pardon this interruption. If I can have one custodian who can assist me in the front office really quick with a big person, I appreciate that. So I just need one custodian to the front office. And thank you so much for everything you do every evening. You make the school look absolutely amazing in the morning for our students and the neighborhood and families and all of our teachers and support staff. So certainly want to thank you for doing a great job. Keep doing it. Thank you so much and have a great evening.
So we've got studios. If y'all don't know what On and Off Red is, it's really awesome. There's 90 studios open all over this area. Beacon Hill, Monta Vista, Alta Vista, anything on Fredericksburg Road. We're kind of a big hub, so there's a ton of really amazing artists, a lot who are museum level, that you don't see except at museums or in really high-end galleries, and they're just there to talk with you. So we're open both days, Saturday and Sunday. You can get catalogs at the Beale House, which is up Fredericksburg, and it's got all the studios that are open. It's really cool. The 18th and the 19th, but there's a giant party at Beale House, which is in the Primrose Retirement Community. It's a little weird, but it's this really cool gallery that's about the size of this, and Callan McIntyre runs it, and she's the one that orchestrates this every year. So y'all are all welcome at the Mill. It's totally Daffy, but you'll love it.
And there's an ad on the back of this month's newsletter. It's got the details about On and Off Red.
And we have a huge show from New York that we did a big exchange with the Hispanic Society, which was a big stinking deal. And y'all see, we'll see the response from artists from New York, Brooklyn, Kansas City, Vermont, lots from San Antonio, and Houston. There it is.
Thank you.
Second announcement, the One Day LP event is for this school right here, happens this Saturday, and the enrollment, the interest has grown up, and we're going to bring in new teachers, and their event next year has been accepted as an official tricentennial event. Is it going to be?
Congratulations.
Awesome.
And her school is school.
All right. Thank you, everyone. Have a great night.